short video series of control engineering in which we are going to cover a lot of topics involved in control engineering. To start with, in the lecture 1 we are going to cover control systems, its introduction and a few examples. Right, so before we begin and jump into the deep of control systems, it is important to understand some basic definitions of control engineering. So we'll start with some basic ones, and the first one is system. So basically, what do we mean by a system? A system is a combination or an arrangement of different physical components. Physical components are those components which we can see or feel. So a combination or arrangement of such components to achieve a certain objective constitute a system. Then what a control system is? So again, it is an arrangement of different physical components connected in such a manner so as to regulate, direct or command. So we are going to regulate, direct or command. Basically, we are going to control the system itself or some other system. So we are going to regulate, direct and command a system itself or some other system using an arrangement of physical elements. And such a system is known as control system. Then plant. Plant is that portion of the system which is to be controlled. Right. So that portion of the system which we are going to control is known as plant. And again, who is going to control this plant? So let us come on to the next definition, which is controller. The element of the system which controls the plant or process is known as controller. Again, this controller can be the element of the system itself, or it can be an external element, right? Then input. Input, again, it is an applied signal, something which we are giving to the system. It is also termed as excitation signal in some of the books. So the system, the signal which is applied to the system, or the excitation signals which is supplied to a control system from an external energy source in order to produce a specific output is known as input. So whenever we give an input to the system, it's obvious that we will be expecting some of the output. So what is an output? It is a particular signal of interest, or to in clear word, it is the actual response obtained from the system. Right. So the response of the system basically is known as the output. Now once we know what is controller input and output, it is obvious to discuss about the important term, which is disturbance. So disturbance is that signal which tends to adversely affect the value of the output. Something which is trying to change the output of the system is known as disturbance. Again, if it is generated within the system, it is known as an internal disturbance. If it is generated outside the system, it is known as an external disturbance. The thing to remember over here that the external disturbance is hard to predict, so it affects the output adversely as compared to the internal disturbance. Okay. Now let's move on to some of the definitions, some more definitions. The control variables. So control variables are those variables which quantify the performance or quality of the final product. So if I have to judge a final product or output of the system, I'll be checking it out with the help of these controlled variables. These are also known as the output variables. And then manipulated variable. As the name suggests, we are going to manipulate something. So these are the variables which are adjusted dynamically to keep the controlled variables at their set points. So we are going to minimize the difference between the set points and the controlled variables. And to minimize this difference, we are going to use manipulated variables. Now to understand these terms better, we'll see a block diagram. Now you can see over here the general block diagram of any control system. There are certain components that we need to remember always while dealing with a block diagram. Right. So I'll start with the first one. The first one is the reference input. The input that we give to the system is known as the reference input. This input will be given to the controller. Right. So controller will be taking some action to control the system, and it will generate a manipulated variable. Right, a manipulated variable again will be given to the plant. So I have the plant which is to be controlled, and the output of this is plant will be my controlled variable. Right, from the variable that I am getting at the output side. Now this controlled variable will be measured using a feedback element. Now once it is measured, it will be given back to the reference input. Using a comparator, they will be compared. Again, based upon the difference between the measured signal and the given signal, the error will be generated, and based on this error, the controller will take action again. Now we have these six components. One is left, which is not shown in this figure, which is known as disturbance. So disturbance is something which is trying to change my control variable or the output of the system. Right. So this is my seventh part. So these seven parts together constitute any block diagram of a physical system. Now, if in the exam or in any place, if you are supposed to draw the block diagram of the system, what you need to keep in mind is you have to identify these seven elements for any of the systems, and you have to draw these seven elements. Is it clear? So these seven elements are reference input, controller, manipulated variable, plant, controlled variable, feedback, and disturbance. Right? Okay. Now moving on to the next topic is the classification. How do they classify a control system? So first and foremost, the most important classification of control system is linear and nonlinear control system. So a control system is said to be a linear control system if it satisfies the first one, the principle of superposition. Now, what is superposition? Let us understand. The superposition, the principle of superposition consists of two parts. The first one is additivity, and second one is homogeneity. The additivity itself means that the output of individual inputs is equal to the cumulative output of the combined inputs. So, if I say if I have two inputs over here, x1 and x2, having individual outputs fx2 and fx1, their summation will be equal to the cumulative output of the combined input x1 and x2, right? So this is the principle of additivity. And then homogeneity. Homogeneity is shown by this equation, which says that a smaller portion x has the output, if multiplied by a, which will be equal to the output of a times x. So let's say if I have a room like this one, right? And if I am taking this small portion of the room as a sample, right, so this portion is represented by x, and if I multiply this portion throughout this a, right, it will be equal to a times x of fx, right? So let's say you can say the density. So if I say the air density at this portion, right, it is equal to f of x. If I multiply it by a, it will give me the entire density in the air of the room, right? Similarly, it will be equal to f of ax. Okay. Then second is, if the system is said to be a linear system if the differential equation describing the system is linear and its coefficients are constants. And the last one is the most obvious one, the output or the response varies linearly with the input. When output varies linearly with the input, the system is known as linear system. Similarly, I can obtain the definitions of nonlinear system. It is going to be the reverse of these three points. Again, I can also classify the system as time variant and time invariant system. So time varying control systems are those systems in which parameters of the systems are varying with time. So if the parameter changes with time, they are known as time variant system. And similarly, when the parameters of systems are independent of the time, it is known as time invariant system. Right. Why these two classifications are important? Because the systems that we are going to consider in this subject are going to be LTI system. Right. LTI basically means linear time invariant system. So if you can see over here, we have linear systems also, what you have understood, and we have time invariant system also. So all the system that we'll be looking for in this subject will be linear time invariant systems. Right. Apart from this, the control system can also be classified as uniform and non-uniform control system. So uniform and non-uniform control system basically depends upon the space or the domain at which the system is working. Right? So I can classify, if the system is going to be constant with respect to space, it is known as uniform system, or else it will be known as non-uniform systems. So and next one is causal. So causal basically is the systems whose output depends on the, whose future inputs depends on the present output. For example, tracking the missile. So if a missile is tracking a target, if the target changes its track, the missile is going to change its track. So the future input to the missile is going to be the present output of the target. Apart from this, we can also classify the system as natural, man-made, or combinational systems. And finally, it can also be classified as continuous or discrete system. So if the output is going to be continuous like this one, I'll get a constituted system, continuous system. And if I get the discrete output, this output at certain interval time, this is known as, then I'll get a discrete system, right? Moving on, another important classification is classification based on the presence and absence of feedback system. You can classify the system as open and closed loop control systems. So there are certain differences that we need to understand between an open and closed loop control system. The open loop control system do not have a feedback. On the other hand, the closed loop control system, okay, this is a mistake, it consists of a feedback, the feedback axis. Now, if I do not have a feedback, the control action will be independent of desired output. Right, it will be independent of desired output because the desired output is neither measured or not, it is given back to the input side of the system. Now, if there is no feedback, there won't be any error detector, which makes the system inaccurate and also highly sensitive to the parameter changes. Now, when the system is highly sensitive to parameter changes, obviously I cannot use it for large range, so it has smaller bandwidth. Similarly, if I talk about a closed loop control system, where the feedback element exists, the control action depends on the desired output because the output is continuously being measured using the feedback element. That means we are detecting any error present in the output side, right? And now when we are checking the error present in the output side, that means the system is an accurate system, and obviously it is less sensitive to parameter changes or the input, which makes the system which can be used for a large bandwidth. Now these are the disadvantages of open loop control system, which are again an advantage of closed loop control system. Now if I move on to the advantages of open loop control system, there is no issue of stability. Because there is no feedback element, the system never tries to stabilize. So it will give you an output depending upon the input. So it is comparatively more stable than the closed loop control system. It consumes it has cheaper and it consumes less power. And it is comparatively easy to design because there are less components involved. Similarly, on the other hand, we have closed loop control system, which has an issue of stability, right? So the system continuously tries to stabilize itself, so the system is comparatively unstable. Cost is higher, and it consumes large power due to the presence of feedback element, and it is difficult to design because we have an extra component involved, right? So if I look at the block diagram, if there is no feedback element, the system is known as open feedback system. And if there is a presence of feedback system, it is known as closed loop feedback system or closed loop control systems. Now let us look at certain examples of open loop control system. The first one is automatic two switch. Now though the name consists of automatic, the system is an open loop control system. Why? Because let's say I set a desired time. The desired time will be given to the controller, will consume some of the power input and start hitting the bread. Now after a certain time, it will give me the actual toast, but the quality of this toast is not measured using a feedback element. So there is no feedback element present, right? So no feedback element present, that means it makes the system an open loop control system. Similarly, if I talk about a traffic light controller, we set a desired time, it will consume some power and the controller will change the light. Now with the help of this light, the traffic will be controlled, but whether the traffic is being controlled or not, there is no feedback time. So if I talk about a conventional traffic light controller, there is no feedback element, so it is an example of open loop control system. Similarly, if I talk about a closed loop control system, any example related to human being is a closed loop control system. We have our senses, eyes, nose, ears, tongue and skin, which acts as a feedback element. So all the examples related to human being, everything that we are doing is a closed loop control system. Similarly, domestic heating system or anything related to temperature, heating or cooling system, right? We usually check the temperature, right? If I talk about an air conditioner or room heater, we check the temperature and based on that the system turns on or turns off, right? So we have a temperature sensor, we have a feedback element, so it is a closed loop control system. Similarly, motor speed control, we usually check the speed of the motor using a tachometer, and based on this we try to change the speed so that the desired speed is compared with the actual speed, and if there is any difference, it is modified. Similarly, missile launching system. Missile launching system also checks the position or the velocity of the target, and according to it, it tracks its path. So we have a tracking control over here, which will be my feedback, right? So due to the presence of this feedback, we can classify this missile launching system as closed loop control system. Now with this, we come to the last topic, that is the examples. So I've taken some of the examples. First of all, the room temperature control system. So if I had to control the temperature of the room, what we are going to do, this is an example of heating, room heating, where we are going to increase the temperature of the room. So what we do is we set the desired temperature, which is converted into electrical form using a potentiometer and giving an input to the controller. Now due to this control signal, the gas-solenoid valve moves either up or down, and with this movement of this gas-solenoid valve, the gas flow rate changes. Now this gas flow rate is used to gas fire, is used in gas fire to generate heat. Now due to this heat, the actual room temperature increases, right? And this temperature is again measured using a thermometer, which gives back the signal, which is feedback element, and gives back the signal. You can see it over here to the power direction. So this is a measure temperature, which is given back to the controller, which measures this desired temperature and measure temperature and takes the necessary action, right? So basically we have these elements, but this is not the block diagram. So if someone asks you to draw the block diagram, this is not the block diagram of the control system. So how does the block diagram looks like? It looks something like this, right? It is simplified form where I can identify all these 7 elements. The rule of 7 is what you have to remember. I'll help you in identifying the 7 components over here. The first one is the input, that is the desired temperature we have given over here, which is converted into the form of potentiometer. Then I have a controller, which will take the control signal. So control signal here is taken by the gas solenoid valve and gas burner. So this control signal, control solenoid valve and gas burner together forms the third component, right? Fourth one is my room or the plant, which is we are going to control. The fifth one will be the actual temperature of the room, which will be measured back using a feedback element thermometer. Sixth, right over here we have the outside temperature, which is going to change the temperature of the room, plus the heat losses. These two together are considered to be the disturbances, and these are the 7 elements which are important in any block diagram. Similarly, if I talk about a computer numerically controlled system or a machine tool, we have a computer program giving input to the digital controller, which runs the DC servo motor. Now this servo motor is used to drive the lead screw as well as the machine tool table. Now we have two feedback devices over here. First one is the shaft encoder, which with the help of a photodiode takes the positional feedback and gives back to the digital controller. Secondly, we have a tacho generator, which measures the velocity, which gives the analog velocity feedback to the DC servo motor, which is further changed as per the demand. Right, this is again not the block diagram, this is just a schematic. If you are being asked to draw the block diagrams look something like this. I'll keep the identification of 7 components to you. Just make sure that these two together form the feedback element. Right, so these two are the feedback element used in this particular block diagram. Rest of the components you have to identify. Again, there are no disturbances given in this block diagram, so it is up to you how you include those disturbances over here. Clear? The last example is an aircraft elevator control system, where we are going to control the elevation of an aircraft. So if I set the desired temperature, set a desired angle at which I had to change the elevation, it is given to the controller, which takes the control action using an electro-hydraulic servo valve, and this valve will move the hydraulic cylinder, changing this piston cylinder arrangement so as to set this angle. Now this angle, this change in angle, is actually measured using an output angle sensor. This is again taken back and measured and taken back to the controller. Now this controller again compares this desired angle and the measured angle to take the necessary control action. Right, again this is not the block diagram, this is just a schematic to understand the working of elevator system. So block diagram will be given something like this. The task to identify 7 basic elements, it's up to you. Just do it as your practice, and by this we complete today's lecture. If you have any queries, you can mail me up on this email ID, and do join the Google Classroom of Control Engineering. Thank you.